Good morning, everybody. Welcome back for another seminar from the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía, in Granada, in Spain. And today we will have the talk by Dr. Giacomo Bonoli from INAF in Italy. And he will talk about fundamental physics from ground-based gamma ray observations. Giacomo will be properly introduced by Dr. Ivan Aguro. Ivan, please.
Thank you very much, René. So, thank you very much, everyone, for coming to the seminar by Giacomo. Thank you also, everybody who is connected by Zoom. Giacomo probably doesn't need an introduction in this audience because everybody knows him from his several visits to the Institute. He was actually working with us for 1 year, a couple of years ago, something like that. And since then, he has been a recurrent visitor and a very intense collaborator of our group. So we are happy to have him here. Thank you for coming again.
I'm happy as well.
He's actually the reason why he left our institute while he was working here is that he got a permanent position as a cercatore, no? In INAF in Italy. He's right now at the Brera Astronomical Observatory, close to Milan. And before he was working with us for a little bit more than a year or so. And before he was, well, he has been working also at the University of Siena, Brera Astronomical Observatory. And I don't know if I have forgotten any other before. So his field of expertise is very high energy gamma ray observations, mainly for extragalactic objects. And he has been having important contributions in mainly in the MAGIC collaboration that has first off in the island of La Palma, where he has held several key roles in the collaboration. And he's now also a member of the CTA collaboration, working well, not only in the field of very high energies, gamma rays in CTA, LST, but also in the Mini-Astre Array, which is an Italian-specific project on which Spain is collaborating as well. Okay, so I leave you with the nice seminar that I'm pretty sure that Giacomo is going to be on fundamental physics from ground-based gamma rays observations, which is quite nice for me actually, because this is physics in the state-of-the-art physics that in principle are going to be able to be done with the new instrumentation that we are building in this field. So please, Giacomo.
So thanks, René. Thanks, Ivan, for the introduction. Thanks for inviting me. It was a pleasure to be here for weeks, 4 weeks full of very nice work together with my old group. And let me also thank Giorgio Galanti and Fabrizio Tavecchio, who provided me with many of the slides that I rearranged for giving this introductory talk to this field, which is quite deep, but I tried to keep it really introductory because maybe that is a bit at odds with the background of many of us. So I will start with some basic toolbox. So the instruments that are used for observing gamma rays from the ground, some words on blazars, and some words on the extragalactic background light, which is one of the key ingredients. Then I will start talking about axial light particles. So the chase of new particles that are, for in this case, foreseen by the string theory, and that could solve some peculiar problems. And on the other side, the chase for signatures of the Lorentz invariance violations. So violations of the Lorentz invariance that happen to that are expected at the Planck scale. So when quantum effects on the related to granularity of space-time should introduce some alteration to what we know from special and general relativity. Actually, many of these things are also a target for laboratory physics, particle physics with accelerators, and it's nice to understand how these two very different worlds can compete and also be complementary into the trying to solve these questions. And then I will end up with something that was published yesterday, and the leader is actually Giorgio Galanti, and is related to the brightest of all times GRB that happened to be observed by LASO and many other instruments in October, and in October 2022. And actually, there are photons of energy that is so high that may hint to an effect related to axions. Let's start. So one of the ingredients are imaging atmospheric Cherenkov telescope. You can count not only the forthcoming CTA, but also MAGIC, HESS, Veritas, FACT, that was working in La Palma next to MAGIC, and also the forthcoming ASTRI mini array, which is an Italian endeavor. And I forgot to mention the LST1 prototype, which is also producing a lot of interest in science. How do these telescopes for gamma rays work? This is when a gamma ray impinges on the atmosphere, it can create a shower of particles. Charged particles, electrons and positrons above the order of 20 MeV of energy are superluminal, so are faster than light in the atmosphere, which has a refractive index which differs from one by a few parts of 10,000. And so there is a flash of light, Cherenkov light, that can be registered. And from this flash of light, the analysis can reconstruct the kind of the progenitor, because there are many more cosmic rays around than high energy photons, but the photons are interesting because they can be traced back in a straight line towards the source of production. And when we have a collection of very high energy gamma rays, above, let's say, 30 GeV in energy, then we can try to reconstruct the energy, which is proportional to the light that is produced, and also to reconstruct the direction. Another kind of instrument, which may attain even higher energies, but with a higher lower threshold, which is quite important, because the lower the threshold, the higher the set of sources that you can assess, because to produce very high energy gamma rays of the highest energies takes a lot of energy, and so the sources are quite rare, is with particle shower detectors. So arrays of detectors that don't detect the light, but detect directly the showers of particles. An example can be Auger in Argentina, or maybe the LASO Observatory in China, and also Hawke in Mexico, or in the future, the SWGO, which is something, some kind of improved Hawke for the Southern Hemisphere. So this is how, for example, the LASO is built. So you have this central blue square, which is made of vessels of detector in water. So this is a water Cherenkov detector, which can attain quite a lower energy than the much bigger KM2A, which is this rounded area, which contains particle detectors and muon detectors that are buried underground. These are very important because one way to discriminate cosmic rays from photons is the muon content. If the shower contains very little muon content, it is rather a gamma ray than a cosmic ray. And this is an example of how it reacts to the arrival of a shower of particles. This it was the detection of almost one PeV photon from the Crab Nebula. So you have that there are many of the detectors that are excited. And of course, the differences in arrival times between the various detectors give the position, the direction of the particle wavefront, let's say. And so one of the important parts is how the sensitivity curve for point-like sources compare between all these instruments. So you have in the future CTA that can attain down to order of 20 GV and goes up to order of 100 TV, so three decades, almost four. And you have the already working Lasso with this double shaped sensitivity curve in red because of the combination of the water Cherenkov detectors and the particle array detectors of the KM2A. And then you have other instruments. What we are comparing here, there is also a gray curve, which is the Fermilat curve that arrives almost at 20 eV, is that for Cherenkov telescopes, these curves are mostly created simulating 50 hours of observations, while we compare for with 1 year of observation with the particular ray detectors. That's why the two instruments will behave in a different way. The angular resolution and energy resolution privilege a bit the imaging atmospheric Cherenkov telescopes, the background rejection as well. The difference is that they need a dark time, they are prone to clouds, and they need to be driven to a direction in the sky, while the particle array detectors monitor continuously all the sky. They can work even during the day and even during the storm. So the duty cycle is much larger. And for steady sources, they can integrate all the time. And so 50 hours of CTA compare more or less with 1 year of LASO integration. So another thing we need, once we can observe sources of gamma rays of very high energy, so from a few tens of GeVs up, we need the sources. Otherwise, we don't have the way to probe the physics that we want to probe. And I will skip speaking of GRBs, that are flashes of radiations that can attain, now we know, of the order of 10 TeVs and more, and have a decaying light curve. We have also persistent sources that are very powerful, that are blazars. Basically, radio loud active galactic nuclei, the center of faraway galaxies, that can launch a relativistic jet, and sometimes this jet is pointed towards the line of sight to the observer, and this profits from relativistic beaming and Doppler effects that enhance the flux that we see. So there is a positive bias towards the observation and the study of this kind of sources. There is a GN unified model, so that basically orientation explains most of the different taxonomy that is present in literature. There are two or three intrinsic differences. So if it's radio loud or radio quiet, so if there is a relativistic jet or not, if there is only a disk or there is no disk, for instance, in the so-called ADAF accretion, and if the inner region of the engine is surrounded or not by clouds of the so-called narrow line region on top the broad line region. So some clouds that provide in the optical spectroscopy narrow or resolved lines and that can contribute to also to the emission of very high energies. So the idea of blazars is that you have a blob with fresh energetic electrons. It's there is a tangled magnetic field. It has some radius. It's flying ahead along the jet at a relativistic speed, and it's seen under a little angle, less than 5 degrees usually, to the observer. The distribution of the electrons is mostly it can be modeled as a power law or maybe two power law connected at the Hebreck energy. And we have mostly two phenomenologies, which is the one of BLX, which can attain, they have this double bump where the synchrotron bump is the first one. The second one is usually attributed to a synchrotron self-Compton effect. So the fast electrons Comptonize the optical and infrared tail of the photons produced by the synchrotron component itself. Or maybe there are the more luminous flat spectrum radio quasars, where there is a second bump that is in the leptonic framework, mostly attributed to the Comptonization of radiation that is produced by the disk and mostly by the lines of the broad line region. So there are other models, I won't ask them. An important role can play the most extreme blazers, so the ones that are producing photons of the highest energies up to several TeVs. And there are some of them that are called extreme HBLs, of which the source 1ES0229+200 is the archetypal one, that are faint in fluxes, but very hard in spectrum, and the peak or the two bumps are moved to the right. And these can be considered as TV beacons that may play an important role in the physics that we want to consider. And they are sources that are the ideal targets within the CTA that is built by three classes of telescopes for the medium-sized telescope and for the exotic part, for the new physics that you want to test for the small-sized telescope, the smallest one. So an important role is played by the EBL absorption. So it's this reaction that makes so that universe is not transparent to gamma rays, because they can interact with ambient target gammas and produce an electron-positron pair, depleting so the flux that is produced at the source. The important part here is that this is a threshold reaction. So for each energy of the bullet gamma ray photon, there is a preferential energy of photons that you can interact with. And there is this rule of thumb, so that at 100 GeV, the preferential frequency is of the order of 2 × 10^15 hertz. And for each decay in energy you rise, or for the bullet, the target photons lower down one decay in frequency. And so there are components of the radiation that fills the universe that are very important. So basically, there is the starlight, mostly in the optical, and there is the radar peak of light energy that is reprocessed into the infrared band by dust. It's not imaged here, but of course, there is also the much denser CMB radiation. The presence of the stragmatic background light that has an evolution not only in frequency or in lambdas in this plot, but as evolution even along the history of the universe. So we are aiming with observation of farther and farther portions of the universe to reconstruct the evolution with the redshift of the stragmatic background light. Is important because it creates a gamma ray horizon, as you see in the bottom part of the plot on the right. For a given flat spectrum, this is the survival probability in some sense. The higher you go in redshift, the lower is the top energy that you can receive at the observer. So there are regions of the universe that are opaque to the very high energy gamma rays at the order of a few hundreds of GeV and more. Okay, this is more or less. An important part is that even for a source, this redshift is not a random choice. This is the redshift of two of the top brightest blazers that we have, the Markarians, Markarian 501, Markarian 421. You can see that the survival probability drops in energy after 10 TeV. And actually, in spite of how hard is the injected spectrum, this is a spectral energy distribution, this is not spectrum, irrespective of how hard is the injected spectrum, you see that already from this very nearby redshift, there is a complete drop at energy of the order of the 30 TeV. So, and if you go to higher distances, the horizon shrinks even more. And so the top energy that you can receive with standard physics lowers down from 30 TeV to lower energies. And this is an important point because one of the things that you want to attain is detection of photons that we wouldn't expect to get from a particular distance, so that they are too energetic for what we expect. And this can be important for detecting new particles. So, as you know, there is the standard model with quarks, mediators, and leptonic families, and Higgs boson. And one historical point of debate was that, in spite of being formed by three quarks, the neutron doesn't show any electric dipole moment. So the wave functions of the three quarks compensate in a way that there is not charge separation, even if the quarks inside are of different have charges of different sign. And so one idea was that while we know that the weak interaction violates the simultaneous symmetry under charge conjugation and parity, the strong force doesn't. But in principle, it could. So it seems that there is some fine tuning of the universe so that it shows some kind of recipe that prevents the violation of the CP symmetry. And this was called the strong CP problem. And a potential solution was a new particle characterized by being neutral and of a small mass. And it was introduced at first by Peccei and Quine in 1977 and other authors later on. The problem was that this should have made some effect on hadrons that was not observed. So they started speaking of invisible actions. It means that you must have a very, very small mass. The action has not been discovered. Some extension of standard model like string theory predict some particles that share the property of action, which are so-called action-like particles, and then can probe a new physics with mass and coupling to the other particles as independent parameters. So the axial-like particles are supposed to be very light, so we have limits of the order of 10 to minus 7 eV, and the interaction that can be is an interaction with two photons. You see that there is in the formula for the Lagrangian term a coupling constant and a scalar product of the electric field of the photon and the B field that can be provided, for instance, by a magnetic an environmental magnetic field. The spin is zero, so they are pseudo they are bosons, and they can interact both ways with two photons. They are also a possible candidate for dark matter. And there are effects that we won't treat on the polarization state of photons that may provide other observables, but this is it's bringing us too far. So what can happen? You can have time reversal that you have a photon that interacts with for instance, with the magnetic field, and an axion is produced, or an axion can be converted back to a photon. And given that you have the scalar product of E and B is the transverse component of B to the propagation direction of the photon, the important part. So one can think of half photon oscillations, and the probability is written in this formula, where this constant M is 1 over the coupling term. And there are some terms. This delta oscillation is basically a sum under quadrature of two terms. And there is a specific situation, the so-called strong mixing, where this delta it corresponds to the B field over the multiplied by the constant. In this case, the probability becomes independent from the mass and from the energy of the photon or the axion. So one can think, okay, to increase the probability, let's go up with the B field, No, because if you increase the magnetic field, there is a competitive in quantum electrodynamics process, the vacuum polarization that suppresses the oscillation. And this is well seen in this panel on the top left. So you have regions where the strong mixing not violated, and so you have a flat conversion probability with the energy, and instead you have these colored parts where you have these wiggles that can impinge some features, for instance, in the observed spectra. So the situation is quite complex, and I will treat mostly the situation of the strong mixing. So, sorry? Yes, this is from the CAS collaboration. We'll show you what it is. It's basically an observe. It's fun. I will tell you. Oops. So the important part is that the Alps are very elusive, we will see. And astrophysical environment is probably the best opportunity to study them. And the effects can be visible in the very high energy band. So below 10 GeV, so in the for the gamma rays that are observed with the Fermi satellites, there is a negligible photon absorption due to ABL. So the effect of the presence of that we want to test of the axions would be that they depress the flux of particles that you see, because a portion of the flux that is produced at the source when it hits the detector is in the axion phase, and so is lost by the detector. Instead, when the EBL induces strong absorption, they can provide the way for the photons to traverse a portion of the universe without being absorbed. So it has an effect of attenuate the EBL absorption. And so you expect that the observed flux is enhanced. The oscillation should increase the medium transparency. Experimental searches, shining light through walls. There is an experiment in desert Hamburg where they use a laser that is the light is crossing a source of magnetic field, and there is an absorber, a wall. What they expect is that another converter makes the axions that crossed the wall change back to the photon state so that a photon detector may observe some light shining through the wall. Another idea is that also stars can be Alp sources, but this constrains the coupling, because if the coupling were very important, this would have effects on the stellar structure and evolution. So, for instance, if you lose energy by producing axions, you would have that the contracting phase is prolonged because the temperature can rise slower. And also, the burning phase would be shortened because you need larger fuel consumption to produce the luminosity in photon that you see. And also, the sun is checked as an axion-like particle source by the CAST experiment, which set the limits on the coupling and the mass that you read on on the slide. So the idea is that some photons are converted into axion-like particles within the sun. They escape, then they can be reconverted by the Earth magnetic field into photons. That should have around 8 keV. So they are no, sorry, they are using I'm mistaken. They here the CAST experiment is at CERN because it's using a superconductive magnet of the CERN is pointing there. This is fixed in direction, so when the sun is crossing that direction, they expect to see some X-ray photons after the conversion in the magnet. So it's a so-called axion scope. The evolution of this is the IAXO experiment, which is an heliostat. So this is not waiting for the sun to cross by, but is just moving to keep the sun into the field of view. And you can see that there are these optics that are optics motivated by X-ray satellites like MUSTAR or XMM. So the idea is here that you have a magnetic field that can convert back the axion produced in the sun to X-rays that you want to detect. So there are many other ways that have been used in astrophysics, and with this you see the blue area is related to the CAST experiment, but there are also limits related to the 1987A gamma burst and to HB stars and so on. The idea is that we want, with new experiments, to fill up the parameter phase, which is bidimensional, the mass of the axion-like particle and the coupling factor, to see if somewhere we find this particle or if we exclude the existence at some point. So coming back to astrophysics, the idea is that if such a process that reduces the EBL absorption of gamma rays is active, you will have that with respect to the case with no axion-like particles, which is on the top right, the emitted spectrum at the source, which is on the bottom left, is not attenuated as we expect by the density of EBL photons that we measure with other in other ways, but should be reduced because of the anomalous transparencies induced by axion. And this can solve a few problems. You see here the observed spectrum of a distant blazar. This should be an Hess spectrum, I think. And when you deabsorb the spectrum, so you make account for the attenuation of the EBL, there is this kind of not really natural rise of the spectrum. This gets convex. So either you have a farther higher energy component intrinsic in the source, which has to be somehow hypothesized, and you should have try to guess which one is this component, or you might try to solve with the axion-like particles. So this is the absorption, it's exaggerated because it doesn't keep into account the anomalous transparency given to by the axion-like particles. And this, for instance, was proposed by De Angelis in 2011. And the idea is that we can try to see if it's the case. Another situation, a bit different, because this was emerging at around above 1 TeV, and is made along the path, is that of a flux spectral radio quasar observed by MAGIC about 10 years ago. This flux spectral radio quasar had a gamma ray flare observed by Fermi and by MAGIC. And the interesting part is that MAGIC observed a very fast evolution of the flare of the time scales of minutes. So when you have 10 scales of minutes, you think of a source that is a region not very big. To have the region not very big, if you consider that the emission is produced at single zone, you should think that given the conical shape of the jet, if you assume it conical, it must be very inner. But if it's very inner, very close to the singularity, then the light has to cross the broad line region, which is full of photons that can absorb gamma rays. So you expect a cutoff, a few GeV's, and you shouldn't detect the source at 400, 500 GeV's. On top of the fact that this flat spectral quasar is quite far away, so there is also the EBL absorption. So one way would be to consider the magnetic field within the jet region and within the broad line region, and with parameters that are quite conventional, you can see that from the standard drop when the that in arises a few hundreds of the GB, that is mostly that is made by the broad line region absorption, With ALPS, you can convert photons to ALPS. The ALPS cross the broad range region, and then they can process ahead towards the observer. And with this work, we accounted for the possibility that the emission is inner, close to the broad line region, close to the singularity, and so within the broad line region, and so it's naturally fast. It can be naturally fast, but is observed by magic because of this transparency effect. The alternative is that the emission is not close to the singularity, but is far away, as in the models, for instance, by Alan Marsh. So in this case, you need to account for variability to think of bubbles of that are, so there are zones that are not as large, as wide as the total jet, but are subregions where you have, for instance, a magnetic reconnection that injects magnetic energy into electrons, and so this radiates outside the broad line region without paying any price to the broad line region absorption. And with this work, we explored this area of the parameters. So you see that it is touching an area which is not excluded so far. I went back. move ahead to this year, more or less, we can have the Hawk observation of TV blazers. Hawk is an experiment with bladders of water with big photomultipliers inside. And this, when the particles cross the water blader, detects the light of the water Cherenkov emission, because you have Cherenkov effect not only in the atmosphere, but also in water with even better gain. You may know these pictures of the inner of the nuclear plants with this glowing blue. This glowing blue is made by Cherenkov radiation, by beta emission of high energy electron. So Hawk is an array similar to LASO, a bit smaller. It has a different sensitivity. And this work uses the spectra of blazars to simulate the extension of the spectra into the Hawk. These blazars are observed by Cherenkov telescopes, and compare the extension at higher energy of this spectra with the Hawk data. Hawk is sensitive to the whole sky above the detector, so it has a huge grasp, the product of the sensitivity with the field of view that is encompassed. And you can see that you may have deviation between the orange, the standard, and the blue spectrum above a few TVs. What they did is to compare this expectation with the data of Hawk, and so they could exclude some portion of the parameter space, in the sense that they had upper limits for many of these sources that were well in agreement with the standard physics and were in disagreement with the hypothesis of axions. If axion like particles with the assumed parameters were there, they should have seen the sources, because there should have been a flux of very high energy photons in their inner band detected by Hawk. And with this work, they could exclude this portion in blue of the parameter space. And now another important topic, which is Lorentz invariance violation. So at the quantum scale, you expect that space and time are not more continuous, as is one of the postulates, one of the basic assumptions in general and special relativity, but you should have an effect of quantization of space and time. And this can be affects the energy momentum relation of particles in this sense, that this is the standard part, before the plus minus. And then there is a value which is related to the scale energy of the effect. And there is a power of the momentum, which can be with n1, so linear case, and 2, quadratic case. And also you have plus minus, so you have superluminal and subluminal effects. In the case of photons that don't have mass, the case is the top right. So you have a term which is correct in the energy momentum relation that is proportional to the energy to the cube divided by the scale energy of the Lorentz invariance violation, the scale of the energy when the effects start to be somehow not dominant, but at least observable. This is expected to be related to the Planck's energy scale, which is of the which is 1.22 times 10 to the 19 GeV. The other important thing is that in the relation for the gamma-gamma pair production, the one of the ABL, there is an additional term. So the minimum energy is, in the subluminal case, increased by an additional factor. This is important because this reduces the amount of photons in the EBL that are useful absorbers for the gamma rays. So you are excluding some targets, and this again creates an extra transparency. These authors in 2014 predicted that in the band of the small telescope of CDA, you should have with different values for different energies, scale of energy, some kind of effect at the order of 20 or so TeVs, where you have that the probability of survival probability from the, in this case, is Markarian 501, so nearby source Z0.03, the redshift. You have that the survival probability at some point increases and then gets to 1, so that the TeV photons are not affected by ABL absorption. There are many astrophysical tests of LIV. I won't even speak about the polarization ones, but the fundamental one that you may have energy-dependent time delays. So you generate a spike which crosses a wave band, so not a monochromatic spike, but some like in a GRB, you go from X-rays to TV band, now we know. And you may have that these spikes has a different speed across the universe because there is a dispersion relations for the vacuum. So in the subluminal case, you have that the higher you go in energy, the slower the photons travel. And the other is pair production threshold shift. I just spoke. This can also affect the observation of the showers in atmosphere. When cosmic rays and gamma rays produce the shower that is observed with Cherenkov telescope and with the particle detectors, if there is this effect, the first interaction, which is based on Bethe-Heitler process, may not start when we expect, but it's a bit more difficult, so it starts lower down. And so this may give effects also at the detection level. Then there are other effects because if you assume LIV, you have that photons may decay in pairs. The easiest is E plus, E minus, electron positron. And you can have also photon splitting. So a photon may produce three photons spontaneously. And then there are maybe polarization effects. But let's go to time delays. This is an ancient work of MAGIC 2017. There was a flare of Markarian 501, and the light curves are produced in different beams of the energy that is observed at the MAGIC. And you see that there is a shift into the barycenter of the feet. Of course, here the signal to noise is not the best you may want, and but in the paper there was some kind of statistical evidence. The most important part is the assumption, because you may think of astrophysical reason, standard ones, that spoil this result. For instance, if the region of emission is not exactly the same, so the path is a bit shorter for the photons that are produced earlier. Or another thing is that you may have a spectral evolution, so that the peak is shifted just because, for instance, you are injecting new electrons in the emission region, and the highest energy electrons, for instance, they cool faster. And so you may have that in competition with the LAIV interpretation, you may have a simple astrophysical interpretation that are maybe easier to accept. The gamma ray burst have this very rapid onset burst, so they also have been exploited to see if the radiation travels at different speed at different energies. And the best constraints so far are from a GRB observed by Fermilab, because it was quite far away. MAGIC in 2019 observed an important GRB, but this is much more nearby. And this effect of delay, of course, is proportional to the distance. So one of the signatures that you may want to find is not only that there is some kind of reasonable relation between the energy and the delay, but also that there is some kind of convincing relation between the delay and the distance. So if you double the distance, you expect to double also the delay. And so it would be very nice to have more sources that at different distances to see if there is a regularity. And the fact that if the gamma ray burst is very nearby, the effect is not as large as it needed to have a robust observable. This is even more for the LASO gamma ray burst of October, of the brightest of all time, because this is even more nearby. So for the linear case, the case where here you have the number one, the distance is the most important part. For the quadratic case, is relevant even the top energy that you reach. So in this case, with the LAT, you are not competing very well with Cherenkov and with the particle detector that can easily attain the level of many tens or even hundreds of tera-electron volts. So back to the effect on transparency. You see that with this is very old CTA sensitivity curve, what you expect in the case of standard physics is the black spectrum of Markarian 501. And if the source is able to have an intrinsic power law, which is without any break or cutoff, and that extends to 100 TeV, because you need that the source is generous enough, you may have that for different energy scales, you have this upturn in the observable spectrum, which is based by the upturn in the survival probability with the energy. So what you have is that in an observation of Markarian 501, you would have some background events, the black histogram, some events that you expect that are not affected, the blue histogram, and you may expect at 100 TeV an extra SS that is justified only by Lorentz invariance violation. Another time, the plot, which on y-axis you have the energy density in absorbers in the EBL, according to different models, Dolago, Knask et al. This is Dominguez, sorry, Knask et al. And you have the evolution of the preferential absorber for photons of a given energy. So what you have is that in standard physics, you have the rule of thumb. So you go up one decade, you go down one order or magnitude in frequency with the target photon. If you have for different levels of the Lorentz variance violation onset energy, scale energy, you may have that there is this upturn. So you go up in energy at the order of several tens of TeVs, and the preferential photons for the absorption is not in the rich density of CMB photons, but it goes back to shorter wavelengths. And this is the reason for having an attenuation of the opacity of the universe. So with Fabrizio in 2016, we made this paper, a bit improving the one of Fairbairn, and on top suggesting that the extreme blazers that are looks like intrinsic beacons of TV, for instance, for 0229, the intrinsic spectrum looks like it's unbroken up to the order of at least 7 TVs. So in that case, you can think that the source is generous enough that you should, with CDA, be able to detect the effect if the spectrum is unbroken, even if the spectrum has a break, and even if the spectrum has a cutoff, like in the bottom panel. This is another work. This is based on Hess. And this is a huge flare of Markarian 501. The two Markarians are able to flare, and they are detected up to 20 TeV with Cherenkov. Then you remember it's very hard to go beyond because of the EBL wall. And so what they did during this flare, they analyzed the spectrum. This is, again, the spectral energy distribution. So it's multiplied by E squared. And they can exclude this upturn, which is the one that they would expect if the energy scale of Lorentz invariant violation is almost twice and something, the Planck energy. So if these were the real effect of LIV, they should have had a significantly richer spectrum at this energy. So they can exclude energies, LIV energies below this one. Of course, the higher is the onset energy of the LIV effect, the higher is the energy until which the standard physics is working in the limit of LIV and scale energy infinite. You get again the standard physics. Actually, this limit was not new, because there was another Markarian 501 flare in the 90s. It was observed by IGRA up to 20 TeV again, and they had more or less the same limits. So this is not adding much. And this is a very nice work by Martinez Huerta, which is reporting a lot of different limits that have been put by different experiments and with different techniques, delay, energy shift, for the subluminal, the top blue, and for the superluminal case, the bottom in green. And now the last portion, what happened yesterday. Yesterday, Giorgio had with also other collaborators from Vera, among the others, me, studied the spectrum of the GRB 2210-09A. So the best, the brightest of all times, the boat GRB. It was an extremely luminous event kind of nearby redshift for GRB, so 0.15, and it almost saturated. Maybe you everybody knows, because it almost saturated any detector on the satellites. So they had a lot of problems to study the first seconds of the mission, because, for instance, the Fermi satellite was saturated. Most of the instruments were saturated, even the ones that were not really in the field of view. So it was an extremely energetic event. We compute that it's maybe one in every century or even more. We are not sure. So the important portion here is that LASO detected one photon up to order of 18 TeV with the widest particle detector array, KM2A. There was also another experiment, CARPET2, that claimed to have detected a 250 TeV photon, but this is not, we don't know if it's confirmed or not. Maybe it's not clear how much is the expected background with this instrument. At the order of 10 TeV from this redshift, the ABL absorption is very strong. If you can assume the different models for EBL that are constructed with different tools, but in the end, if you go to 18 TeV, you see that the survival probability is of the order of 10 to the minus 9, 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 7. So to even to detect one, it must have been a production which is really, really huge. So Giorgio modeled all the process of axion-like oscillation between photons and axion-like particles from the GRB jet within the host galaxy, because it happens to be a spiral galaxy that is seen edge-on, so the flux has to cross through the disk, and there is a model for the magnetic field in the galaxy. Then it has to cross the cosmic voids when we have some assumption for the intensity of the magnetic field and the dimension of the domains. Then it has to come into our galaxy when it is finally reconverted. And so you have that, now I will skip this. What you see here, this is the Lasso spectrum for this event in different time beams, because of course it is a decaying flux, up to 7 TeV with the inner array, the one of water Cherenkov detectors. And this is perfectly fine with conventional physics. Then we extrapolated the spectrum about 10 TeV, which is the best you can expect if you don't assume that there is another intrinsic component uprising the spectrum. And what you have with the standard physics is the red curve. What you have if you assume axion-like oscillation to axion-like particle is the green curve, where the survival probabilities is much enhanced around 15-18 TeV. And you can compare this with the Lasso sensitivity curve. So the idea is that this high energy photon, the resolution in energy is not, let's say, carved in the bronze. So if the energy is not exactly that one, but is a bit lower, of course, the survival probability in standard physics improves. But the idea is that this detection of one photon from this event with Lasso at the order of 15 TeV is quite at odds with conventional physics. It may hint to this axion-like oscillation to axion-like particles. The other photon, the one claimed by Carpet 2 at 250 TeV, cannot be explained by the extra transparency induced by axions, but can be justified by a Lorentz invariant violation effect. So you have this upturn in the survival probability that is with this assumption that are here at the order of 100 TeV. So in this case, you might have such an evidence. Of course, we need robust data to assess it properly. And so this event is not confirmed. Just a summary. With no exhaustiveness and also jumping many of the details, I try to show you that observation of astrophysical sources of gamma rays in the very high energy regime, and especially at several tens of TeV, effectively can compete with particle physics experiments for the search of new particles like axion-like particles. Anomalous transparency to gamma rays of the universe in the 1040 TeV can be still ascribed to axion-like particles, but not to Lorentz invariance violation, which has to be relevant above. Anomalous transparency above the 40 TeV is better explained with Lorentz invariant violation. We need better instruments better knowledge of the sources and the environment, so checking better the EBL, checking better the intergalactic magnetic field, knowing better the magnetic field in the galaxies and also in our galaxy. And we need to be reactive and cover these lucky events, which don't need to be exceptional once in a lifetime, like the boat GRB, but this event can shine a light on these hot topics. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Giacomo. So, Ivani, if you want to manage the questions in the room, please.
Yeah, thank you. Before I forget, let me remind you that if you want to interact with Giacomo, you have another opportunity, well, in a few minutes. We have met at 2 at the entrance of the BNC to have a large interaction with the speaker, with Giacomo. And that reminds me that you can mention at the beginning of the talk that it's a visit program at the Institute, and we communicated with the directors of the program that we would maximize as much as possible interaction with the visitor. That has happened a lot during the last days and weeks, but you have your last opportunity today because he's leaving tomorrow back to Italy. So if you want to have
that, desafortunadamente.
We are very sad, but because he's in our nice celebration in a couple of days. So, okay, questions, if there is any?
So the important part, given that you are not sure about this Carpet 2 event, the portion on LIV is just a speculation, but if such a photon comes from that GRB, axion-like particles cannot help, okay? So it's too energetic, and you need to call for Lorentz invariance valuation effects. But this is, okay, the minor part. The important part is that the 15 TeV photons observed by Lasso, it's at odds with the survival probability in the conventional physics case, because you should have an intrinsic spectrum that is basically too high to get that single photon survive until the detector. And so if you assume that there is this process with photon ALP oscillation all across the travel, because the model encompasses the GRB jet, the galaxy, the intergalactic space, and our galaxy, then you have this enhancement of many orders of magnitude in the survival probability. So detecting this photon is not anymore improbable, assuming that the intrinsic spectrum is this unbroken power law, that is the blue one in the plot. There are models that are so the model comes from basically. From there are two ways here. As a model, and the Starburst galaxy M82, which is nearby, so well known, or a spiral galaxy. We have an example which is our own, which is of course not very well known, but is the best that we know. And there are models also for the magnetic field in other galaxies with radio observations and things that I don't know very well. But,
I have a question myself, actually, regarding to that, because for the models, for the case of the ALPs, I mean, there are no errors, and I guess specifically in the, not so much perhaps in the galaxy's magnetic field, but in the intergalactic magnetic field at large scales,
yes,
there could be a lot of uncertainties on that.
Yes.
How bad or good are those models in predicting the population of IoTs with regard to the
so this in this case the intergalactic space is not that much, so it should be not that much relevant to the finite survival probability. So is more the source part that is, but yes, of course, you have uncertainties in all the parameters that you put inside the magnetic field and also the coherence length of the magnetic field. And so you have to make assumptions on how coherent is on largest distances the magnetic field.
Okay, another question?
This PRV, what was the distance?
Then 0.15. 15. So 5 times the Markarians.
5 times. Then we're seeing already 20 dBs from Markarians and seeing something like 18 from this GRV.
Yes, but then you have the survival probability for the 20 TV at Markarian that scales that probability yeah. to the fifth power, so it drops a lot.
Okay, perhaps on Zoom, René? No?
No question here, no.
Okay, so in that case, leave it here. Thank you very much, Giacomo.
Thank you.
So remember.